These chaotic critters cost Americans over $5 billion per year, caused by the damage they leave in their wake. Some eat their queens alive, and others arm themselves with sticky goo, ready to detonate at a moment's notice. And yet, they're also some of the greatest architects in the animal kingdom. There's something relatable about them. They create beauty while leaving a trail of destruction. They fight each other for power, they go to war, and they sacrifice themselves for their families. Most of them are good, but the few bad ones give them all bad rep. Termites, they're just like us. Hey, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. Today, we're digging deep into the chewed-up world of termites. Now, when most people hear the word termite, they picture one thing, the home destroyer. Creaking walls, chewed-up baseboards, and astronomical repair bills. But the truth is, the termite family includes over 3,000 species, and the vast majority are totally chill. They're often compared to ants, bees, and wasps due to their large colonies and caste systems, but they're actually more closely related to another of our most misunderstood pests, the cockroach. Termites evolved from wood-eating cockroaches, scavengers that gnawed through fallen logs in solitude. But somewhere along the evolutionary line, something changed. They organized into colonies, into castes, into civilizations! What was once a solitary insect became one of the most coordinated forces in the natural world. It's such a fascinating glow-up that we asked one of the world's top experts on termites to tell us how this happened.
My name is Thomas Schwank. I'm an associate professor at the University of Florida. I study termite biology there. Termites are considered as white ants by analogy because they have such interesting evolutionary convergence with social hymenoptera, like ants specifically, and also to some extent bees and wasps. But truly, termites are actually a sister group to a wood roach, which is Cryptocercus, which is a very cool cockroach that is only found in logs in the forest, like in the Appalachian forest, and there's some population in Korea and remnants of archaic times. But the idea is these cockroaches already display a case of biparental care. They already feed on wood and they rely on specific microbes in the gut to digest the wood. And all the molecular phylogeny shows that this is a true sister group to all the termites, and that the common ancestor between these cockroaches and all termites already have a case of biparental care, protease dependent for the gut, for the digestion of wood, and living in a single piece of wood, which was the thing they could digest, which virtually nothing else can do.
In other words, cockroaches that could digest wood and could communally take care of babies evolved over time into eusocial animals thanks to their ability to bite more than what most animals can chew. They can eat wood. So what exactly are termites after when they chow down on wood? The answer is actually fiber or cellulose, if you go by the more technical term. This is the compound that makes up the walls of plant cells. It's what makes wood stiff, tree leaves stiff-ish, and your cereal relatively healthy. We can't digest it, but termites can, thanks to special microbes in their guts that break it down and turn it into fuel. Pretty cool. Evolutionarily, it's a brilliant strategy. Cellulose is one of the most abundant organic compounds on Earth. It's everywhere. And very few animals can digest it. It's another chapter in the eternal evolutionary arms race between plants and insects. And in this case, termites have the greatest weapon, a cellulose-shredding gut biome. Baby termites aren't born with them, so they have to get them from older termites, in a variety of icky ways. Yeah, it's weird, it's kind of gross, but it's one of the big reasons why termites can do what almost no other animal can, turn wood into food. Eating cellulose is one of the big things that makes a termite. Their other key defining trait is their eusociality. They live in highly structured colonies with specialized castes, workers, soldiers, and breeders or reproducers. Each caste looks different, acts different, and serves a unique role. Workers build and maintain the nest, forage for food, and even feed the other castes. Soldiers are often equipped with massive jaws or chemical-spraying heads. They protect the colony. And then there are the kings and queens, the royal couple. In some species, a queen can live for decades, laying thousands of eggs each day. In huge colonies, there can even be dozens of reproductive individuals all working in parallel. But they're usually still organized around one dominant queen. It's a tremendous level of organization for descendants of wood cockroaches. How did they get here?
Eventually, where the cockroach and the termite split, something happened. Some of the young inside the colony, again, very anthropomorphic, decided to stay and instead of dispersing too early and help their younger sibling. And that kind of fed into a positive feedback of altricial development and leading to alloparental care, which means the young start taking care, and then which means mom and dad only focus now on reproduction instead of continuing providing biparental care. And that leads to colonies that got bigger and bigger, and then led to a fantastic diversification in the past 150 million years, which leads to what you know as termites now.
In a small selection of about 25% of termite species, there isn't a fixed worker caste. Instead, juvenile termites pull temporary duty as workers, and later molt into soldiers or reproductives if needed. It's a more flexible system, but the teamwork still holds. And despite bees and ants getting more credit for their amazing societies, termites did it first, roughly 10 million years before ants and 50 million years before bees first turned into massive societies. And most amazingly, termites are societies made of kids. In bees and ants, by the time the workers get out of the colony, they have gone through metamorphosis and turned into adults. But termites are stuck in the juvenile stage of development. The only adults are the reproductive pair, the young who are getting groomed to be a king or queen, and the winged termites who fly out to start new colonies elsewhere. It's like Lord of the Flies, but with baby wood-eating cockroach cousins. Wait, is it though? Being in the termite royal family might sound like an idyllic life, but there's lots of perils. One of the main dangers is that being that much bigger than your kids also means that you're made of a lot of nutrients that can feed a lot of mouths. Mouths that, by the way, you made.
Termites have a basic rule. Recycling is the rule. You need to recycle anything because they feed on wood, which is really poor in nitrogen. Therefore, cannibalism is your fate. If you're a termite, you will be cannibalized by your nestmates by the end of your life. Cannibalism is deeply rooted in the biology of termites as a way to recycle nitrogen so they can continue to grow as a colony, because wood is just fuel, it's no protein. The idea that when something is dying, is recycled, is just inherent nature of termites. It doesn't matter if you're a worker, a soldier, a king, or a queen. So as a queen is wounded, she starts bleeding and therefore is not going to make it. The queen is cannibalized because it's what termites do. There's no reason in any evolutionary scenario why the termite would cannibalize their queen just for fun.
So despite what you might have seen, termites eating their queen isn't some sort of coup d'etat or a self-destructive craze. The queen is usually already dying by the time the workers start eating her. In some species, a dying queen might actually release chemical cues to tell the workers to eat her. Remember, recycling is the rule. But okay, enough of royal cannibalism. Let's get into some of the most interesting among the 3,000 known termite species. Starting with the ones most likely to make you cry, the subterranean termites.
they can form extremely large colonies. Like for native sub, it can be maybe 500,000, maybe up to a million. For Formosan sub, it can be 5-10 million, and maybe same for the Asian subs. Although the colonies that I have in the lab is 2.5 million max for now. So still, a lot of math to feed.
One of these termites that really lives up to their bad reputation is Reticulatermes flavipes, better known as the Eastern Subterranean Termite. This is one of the few species that cause serious damage to human structures, and they're really good at it. These termites are the most destructive species in North America, with mature colonies that can number anywhere from 20,000 to a staggering 5 million workers. If they were human, a large colony would be like the third largest city in North America. They spread silently, tunneling underground and slipping in through foundational cracks as thin as a credit card. Once inside a home's walls, they build hidden mud tubes between the nest and their food source, like a tiny subway system of dirt. Most people don't know they're there until the damage is done.
So to protect yourself, historically, we have used liquid termiticides of sorts, and they've been banned over the past 50 years through the EPA, like chlordane, heptachlor, dieldrin, DDT, and many others. There's a long list of that. And they've been now replaced by non-repellent liquid termiticide that have a relatively half-life, a small half-life. So within 5 years, most of the product is basically decomposed and gone, so it doesn't bioaccumulate like it was the case for a previous termiticide that have been banned for that specific reason. The idea is to create a barrier, a chemical barrier that anything trying to get through dies. So any termites that is trying to access the structure by going through this treated soil dies within a few days or within a relatively short distance from the treatment area. So you keep the termites out of the way.
But there's a potential snag. New research shows that in high concentration zones, where many termites die after exposure, their corpses may actually release chemical cues that warn others to stay away. It creates what's known as a death zone, a morbid little warning sign that tells termites to turn around. Instead of spreading the poison, the colony reroutes and survives, which might save your house, but could send them straight to the next snack over, possibly your neighbor's place. So instead of these death zones, researchers are working on less immediate but more thorough ways of destroying the colonies. Baits.
These baits are completely different philosophy and mode of action. And as termites forage in the ground around the structure, they intercept it, they feed on it, they share it with everybody through food exchange, like all social insects do, and nobody is affected until 20 to 25 days, where the brood start collapsing. Within 45 days, all workers start to be impacted, and within 75 days, the colony is pretty much eliminated, as all termites need to engage in their molting process.
It's more hardcore than it seems. Basically, the termite will go through the motions of molting. It'll get ready to shed their old exoskeleton as a new one is growing underneath the old one. But as the one beneath isn't structurally sound, and after losing the old one, the termite bursts. Aren't you glad that you don't have new skeletons growing within your current skeleton? You're welcome for that thought. But not every termite explosion is meant to destroy colonies. Take Neocapritermes terracua, for example, also known as the exploding termite. These forest dwellers are found in the rainforests of French Guiana, and they've evolved a defense strategy that's one of the most intense and explosive that we've ever seen. When danger comes crawling in, usually ants or rival termites, the older workers burst open, releasing a sticky blue chemical that glues the attackers in place. It's nature's version of a kamikaze mission, a final act of defense from termites who have aged out of regular duties. It's one of the most extreme defense strategies in the insect world. We did a whole episode on these kinds of self-destructive acts. Check it out after this episode. Termites are also unexpected major parts of the Earth's climate. Across tropical and subtropical regions, they're quietly playing a major role in how carbon moves through ecosystems. When a tree falls in the forest, does anybody hear it? You can bet the termite does, and it shows up ready to kickstart new life. Instead of letting dead wood sit around and slowly rot, termites speed up the process, breaking it down and releasing carbon and nutrients back into the soil and atmosphere. As an illustration, check out how quickly these termites break down a few pieces of wood shaped like a house. That's a good thing. Carbon cycling helps fuel new plant growth, stabilize soil, and keep entire ecosystems running. In the Amazon, termites process up to 30% of the dead plant material on the forest floor. And in termite-rich areas, scientists have found more moisture, more nutrients, and less flammable debris, even during droughts. In other words, more termites equals fewer forest fires. Not only do termites clean up the forest floor, some actually help grow the forest too. And that's not all they grow. From forest friends to agricultural experts, meet the Macroterminidae, a subfamily of African and Asian termites that have mastered farming. These termites build massive underground chambers to cultivate a very specific crop, Termitomyces fungus. They grow it, feed it, prune it, and harvest it, just like full-time farmers. Workers start by collecting dead plant material, pre-digesting it, and depositing it into carefully maintained fungus gardens. From there, the fungus does the heavy lifting, breaking down the cellulose and making the nutrients easier to absorb. The termites then eat the fungus itself. It's a tightly run agricultural loop, organized, large scale, and of the termites, by the termites, and for the termites. While termites can digest cellulose on their own, the process is slow and energy intensive, which is why some species outsource the job to fungus, making it easier to absorb. And this deconstructive duo, in addition to preventing forest fires and helping to release carbon, might also help us tackle one of the biggest environmental problems of our time: plastic. In the lab, researchers are isolating some of the termites' gut bacteria, along with the fungi that live in termite nests, analyzing their enzymes and testing their ability to break down different types of plastic. They've had some early success, especially on certain biodegradable kinds. It's not a silver bullet yet, but it could be another unexpected solution from one of nature's most underestimated animals. They help regulate the environment and run underground farms. What's next? Are they also certified HVAC technicians? Actually, yes. In the Australian outback, Amitermes meridionalis, or the magnetic termite, build giant, razor-thin mounds that tower over the grasslands like rows of gravestones, all perfectly aligned on a north-south axis. It's all for thermoregulation. By orienting their mounds this way, the wide side catches the soft morning and evening light, while the scorching midday sun only hits the narrow edge, helping keep the inside cool, even as surface temperatures soar. No one's sure exactly how they do it, but scientists think they use cues from the sun's position and temperature gradients in the soil to orient their construction. It's instinct and evolved engineering. In a habitat with no shade and brutal daily temperature swings, this alignment gives them a survival edge. It's climate-conscious architecture, developed by insects over thousands of generations. So yeah, termites might be chewing through your deck, but they're also holding up the forest, cycling carbon, preventing wildfires, farming underground fungi, and maybe, just maybe, helping us crack the code on plastic waste. They may not be great roommates, but termites are evolutionary legends. For over 100 million years, they've outlasted empires, ice ages, and everything in between. And if they keep this up, they might just help save the world, one chewed up log at a time. So So what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching. See ya!